message and song. And one of the things that I'm so appreciating about the music here is every single Sunday it just packs a message. I'm always the second sermon that you hear. You sing the first one. And those are important messages for us to sing and to hear and to believe. And I see the responses on your face, and I know that's resonating with you. And I certainly want to celebrate as well. I invite you to turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. And then today, as we return to these few scriptures here this morning, and we're looking into it, working into a new passage, a new thought that Peter is going to develop. We'll look at it in just a moment. You may know this already, but there are two basic worldviews that exist out there among humans. There is one view of the world that just says that the world is just one big accident. It's meaningless. There's no direction. There's no purpose. We're all subject to the forces that are at play and fate itself. We really should not expect any sort of meaningfulness to come out of really anything. And there may be a whole that worldview. In fact, Richard Dawkins, you may or may not recognize that name. He's a well-known atheist, British professor, and self-proclaimed philosopher in science field. He's a scientist, but he likes to philosophize as well. This is what he said. He said, "A universe of blind physical forces and genetic replication." This is science coming out. He says, "Some people are going to get hurt. Other people are going to get lucky, and you won't find any rhyme or reason in it, nor any justice. The universe that we observe has precisely the properties that we should expect. If there is, at bottom, no design, no purpose, no good, no evil, nothing but pitiless indifference." Well, who wants to live according to that? Well, even this, apparently. That's right. And there does appear to be senseless suffering in the world. Have you ever suffered and you just wondered why, or you ever want something to say, why in the world? In fact, if there's anyone here that can explain all of the suffering that just is coming to your life, would you just stand and explain that to us right now? We'll get in a second. All right, I don't see any takers on that. I can't explain all of the suffering. I can explain about 99% of it. It's my stupidity. All right? That's it. All right? It's my own stupidity. It's caused most of the suffering in my life. Maybe not 99%, but a lot of it. How many testify to that? All right? If you testify that in your mind, I see you all agree with me that I'm not stupid. That's what you're saying, is that you're better? That's it. I don't know. I know. I do. That's right. That's right. Misery does not come away. That's very true. But, so there does appear to be a lot of senseless suffering in our world. Karl Marx, the 19th century atheist, this is what he said. This is what some people do. He said they turn to religion. And he called, Karl Marx called religion the opiate of the masses. It is that which we bring into our life, we bring religion, we bring faith into our life to just sort of ease the painful realization that everything is meaningless. It's our way of trying to bring some meaning into our life. It's just an opiate, he says. Well, Karl Marx has been gone for over a century, and I don't know exactly what he thinks right now, but I can imagine what he may be thinking. But again, the Bible doesn't deny that there is suffering that often does not make sense to us. We read about that in the book of Job. Now, I'm not going to go through it, but the sermon series is not a series on Job. It is a series on suffering. There's a lot that is Job. At the end of the day, this is what Job's suffering was all about. Even though he and his friends, they went through all of the possible explanations for why he could be suffering so intensely, none of them worked. None of those explanations explained it. And at the end of the day, it was simply this, that we actually read this in Job chapter 1. We actually are told the very beginning of the explanation. As the story unfolds,
friends reading this story, and it's about them trying to figure out what the explanation is. But we're told in chapter 1, it is that God is proving to Satan himself that there is someone, namely his servant Job, who serves and fears the Lord, not because of all the wealth and the prosperity and the riches that God had allowed him to have, but that in fact Job would serve and fear the Lord and love the Lord even all those things were taken away if Job had nothing but God. That's what God tells us. That is why he allowed Satan to afflict Job so intensely, just to prove to Satan that we can love God for no other reason. Right? The purest love is love that loves for no other reason other than that you are you. And God is God. Right? It's the purest reason. Have you ever found out that someone said they love you because of some other reason, something you can bring into their life? Almost the proverbial couple is the one who is trying to marry up into maybe money or power or prestige, right? Yes, and people look on you, oh, we know why he married her. She has some money. Right? That would be love for some reason, right? If it is love at all, it's really love for money, right? But we all want to look for and need love for no other reason than that I am me and you are you and God is God. That's pure love, right? We know in 1 Peter chapter 2, Peter begins to give us a description of the Christian's identity. And we're just going to look at a few verses here, but it really extends all the way down through through verse 12. We're going to look at just a few of those verses. We're not going to work all the way through verse 12 today. But he gives to us 9 different descriptions or words, terms, to identify the Christian. And here's where all this is about. If we're talking about just finding our purpose, receiving from God our meaning and the design that he has for us. Why do we love God? We love God for who he is. We are Christians because of who Christ is, right? Now, I've often been to funerals of Christians where much was made of all of the wealth and the material images of heaven. Like, oh, she's walking on the streets of gold and she's seeing the gates of pearl, and there was much made of all of the beauty and the wealth of heaven, which, great, wonderful, right? But I don't serve Jesus to camp out by a gate of pearl, right? Like all that imagery that John has given to us, which I believe that imagery, but he is trying to put the best of human language, the abundance of goodness that just emanates from a close relationship with Jesus Christ. And when you are with Jesus, when you're in Jesus, and when you are in love with him, that good things happen. They do happen. We know that the world that is anti-Jesus, and so we ought not to be surprised when bad things happen. And so as we go through life, we try to sort out how do we skirt around the evil things, how do we avoid the pain and the suffering, but how do we achieve, or how do we at the end receive what is good from God, the good he has for us, the joy, the eternal joy that he has for us. We find that there's only one way, and that is knowing our identity in Jesus Christ, following Jesus alone, right? And so it's vital for us to know who we are. Now, there's a lot of talk today in this world about identity. Identity, we'll talk about this a little bit. I'll probably return to this series after Easter. I'll give you some stories about this, but our identity matters, right? It matters to us. In fact, I don't have my wallet on me. But probably many of us here will have some sort of identification who I think or something. It tells us who we are, right? If you ever forget, you just pull that out and remind yourself of who you are, right? So somebody has to prove who you are, right? There's a lot of not just concern, but there's a lot of confusion about identity, isn't there? In our culture, a lot of confusion about what is this and what is that? What's it mean to be a man? What's it mean to be a woman? What's it mean to be this or that? I'm sorry you to share some stories. You didn't have permission to share them, so I'm not going to. But some stories that you share with me are things that you have encountered in the workplace or in life are just astounding to me that people who clearly are not what they say they are, but they say they are, and so what do you do with that, right? Identity. But you know, identity is a big deal in the church, too. Who are you? Who are we? Who are you as an individual? Who are we as a church? Who are we as a church? What would you tell someone? What would you tell someone if they ask, "Wow, so what is the phrase of Bible Holiness Church? What's the meaning of Bible Holiness Church? What is a church anyway?" Curious question. Do you know how you'd answer? What's a church? We love God, we love people, right? Yeah. But Peter is going to give to us our identity here. And what he's going to tell us is our identity. It is all wrapped around one person, and that's Jesus Christ. So, however you would describe our church here, I hope the first words out of your mouth might be something like, you know, a Christ following, right? Maybe a Christ centered. Something where Christ is first, right? Because if Christ is not first, if he is something other than first, we have ceased to be a church. Cease to be the body of Christ. As we will see in this first illustration that Peter gives to us, everything in the church must be aligned with the cornerstone, who is Jesus Christ. And as soon as something is not in alignment, you're no longer part of this great temple that God is building. Let's dive in here. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. As you come to him, as you come, and so right off the bat, we know that Peter is speaking to believers. As you, believers, come to him, who is him? It's Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus Christ? He is a living stone rejected by men. If you are a believer in Christ, one who has come to him, don't forget who it is that you are following. We are following the one who was rejected. I don't know about you. I'm a pretty competitive person. I think maybe the only person more competitive in this room right now might be Steve Wagner. Right? Pretty close. We'll take that up in the court sometime and see. But I'm a very competitive person. You're a pretty competitive person, right, Steve? I can speak for Steve on this. We do not like when our team loses. Steve, are you like me? If your team has college basketball, football, whatever it is, no matter what the sport is, if you're a fan, if your team loses 10 in a row, you just stop paying attention to them. Just like me, fair weather fans, I'm a total fair weather fan. If my team loses, goes on losing streak, I just have no idea. What's that? Yes. Yes. Exactly. That's right. I've had people say, well, why are you watching an old game? Because they won. I don't watch the game they're playing now because I don't know if I want to watch it yet, right? Exactly. Anyone else like that with it? Okay, Steve and I, all right, thank you. There are three of us brothers here. You're on the same boat. The rest of you just waste time watching to see whether or not your team's going to win or lose, right? So, that's competitive, right? Competitive. Nobody wants to follow someone who is losing perpetually, unless you're a Cubs fan. You don't want to watch someone who is perpetually losing. Right? So this is so counterintuitive that our identity would be wrapped up in someone who is rejected, who is cast away, a living stone but rejected. One who, and yet he was one, as Isaiah says, who bore our grief, carried our sorrows, was pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities, wounded for our healing, oppressed and afflicted, led as a lamb to the slaughter, he was killed and he was buried. That's not exactly a recipe for winning president of the United States, or king of the universe, or whatever it is you might be running for. Jesus was not a populist. He wasn't putting his finger in his Galilean winds to see which way the wind was blowing. Was it? He knew exactly who he was and where he was going and what his purpose was. And when the world liked it, so what? When the world didn't like it, so be it. He did not budge one centimeter from the purpose that he came for. That's why it's so important for us to know our identity in Christ first, so we don't budge one inch from who Christ is. Now, we may have many other things that we can use to describe who we are as persons, as individuals, as a church. There may be many other things we may use to describe this, but if it starts anywhere besides Christ himself, we've always stopped or started in the wrong direction. He wasn't a populist. He didn't change his message based on polling data. The establishment loathed him, and they feared him, because he was not given to the whims of what was popular. The crowds at one moment would flock to him, and at another moment would abandon him. His own disciples, who were so eager to drop all of their fishing equipment and follow him, yet in the moment of loss, abandoned him. He was like a stone rejected by builders. Just like a modern builder might examine the integrity of their lumber. You ever take a 2x4 to look at it to see if it's warped or just got, you know, serve the purpose that you need? Well, the same way the ancient builders would carefully choose their stones to ensure that they would all fit together, especially that cornerstone. The large, smooth boulders, and sometimes they would inscribe something into it. It would take time if it needed to be a little bit taken off here, something smoothed out here, in order to fit in the right place where everything would align to it. Something had to be square, because it served the reference point for the rest of the building. But Jesus became that cornerstone. Now this image of Jesus being the cornerstone, we find it throughout the New Testament. We find it in the Old Testament, several passages here that we may look at. Some today and some in our next sermon. Psalm 118, Isaiah 8, Isaiah 28, where the Messiah is the cornerstone, and he is the stone, but he's also the stone that builders rejected. He is the stone that people stumble over. Jesus identifies himself as this stone in Mark 12, and in Matthew 21, and in Luke 20. Paul identified Jesus as the stone rejected by the builders in Romans 9, and Ephesians 2. And so we find this almost a dozen times Jesus referred to as the cornerstone. But let's consider the contrast here. Because again, Peter says, as you come to him, a living stone rejected by men. There's a difference between the stone that they use for pavement and the stone that they would use as a cornerstone. Right? Pavement can be made out of whatever kind of rubble they have. Little stones, and mix that all up with the asphalt, and you can do whatever you got to do to make something maybe a little bit smoother for people to travel on, to trot on, to walk over, right? On one hand, Jesus was treated as a useless stone, thrown away until a pile of rejected stones that would be crushed into gravel, used perhaps by the Romans for pavement. Pavement to be made from rubble. But on the other hand, Jesus, Peter tells us, became the chief cornerstone, the most important stone in the whole building. It requires tremendous attention, detail, smoothness, alignment. Everything is going to be placed in reference. That's the whole point of the cornerstone. Everything. You've got to put it there first, right? I'll throw a few other stones together, start a wall, and just again put the cornerstones. I was over in Israel back several years ago, and we were digging. Archaeologists have found this city. It's actually a city that's mentioned in scripture. It's really exciting. And the scripture says it's a city with three gates. And so we wanted to find the gates. So we got to digging. And we had been digging for 6 years by the time I got there. But the year I was there, this was our final year. Whenever we dig, if we find it, great. If we don't, it must not be there. It must be wrong. Well, we started digging. And there were two or three of us in one space. And we were getting to some stuff that was 1,000 years old, not anything, that's rubble. 2,000 years old, time of Jesus, not anything, that's rubble. We come across that stuff all the time. Keep digging. We're looking for things that are 4,000 years old, all right? King David time, all right? In fact, the city that we're digging, we think we're digging it, is a story mentioned in the David and Goliath story. It's called The City of Two Gates. It's in scripture. And so we're digging in this pit, and we're several feet down, and we come across a rock formation that appears to be a wall. It looks like it, okay, these are clearly stained. Like this is purposeful. And so we call one of the chiefs over, and he's like, okay, this is interesting. All right, so he set out the plans, and we got digging, and he told us, here's what you're looking for. What you're looking for is you're looking for that cornerstone. You find a cornerstone, then you know we found something important. Right? When we kept digging, you know, by the time we were done digging, both gates were uncovered. How do we uncover the gates? Because the gates had, the arch wasn't there anymore, right? You can tell there was a cornerstone here, and there was a cornerstone here, and from there the walls went out. One of the walls is facing to the south, overlooking the valley of Elah, which is where David and Goliath fought. And then out here, there is another gate, and this gate was facing to the west. And it was the same thing, cornerstone. But we had to find that cornerstone. We had to orient everything according to the. And man, it was just so exciting. We found the cornerstone. We didn't have to uncover the rest of the wall. We knew it was there. We found the cornerstone. It was a success. This is it. This is the city with two gates. By the time we were done, we had uncovered at least part of the walls on all four sides. And guess what? There were no gates on the other, on the north or on the east. We found the city with two gates. It's so exciting. But we had to have our reference point. And if our identity is wrapped up in any other reference point, then you are already moving away from where Christ wants us to be. To sinful men, Jesus was nothing more than rubble. But to God and God's plan for salvation, Jesus is the cornerstone, precious to the builder and the giver of life. So he says, view yourselves like living stones. In verse 5 now, he says, view yourselves now. Jesus is the cornerstone. You, like living stones, now you are being built up. In reference to Christ, you're being built up to a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. This whole image of being built up, in reference to the cornerstone, is God building a temple. God is building a temple, beginning with Christ. Everything in the temple has reference to Jesus Christ. And you think, okay, so who are the living stones? The living stones are you and me. Just like Paul in 1 Corinthians 12 or Romans 12 or Ephesians 4, he refers to us as members of a body, right? We're all members of a body, Jesus Christ himself being the head, right? The head determines the direction, right? If we see someone walking out here and your head's going one way, your body's going the other, we're all going to be a little freaked out, right? Because your head determines your direction, right? Your head determines your direction. It guides your body. God, Christ is the head of the body. And here Peter uses the body language, the building language. And we are all living stones within the building. What is this building? This building is a temple. What's a temple for? A temple is for a dwelling of God. That's why you build temples. And ancient Near East. There were temples all over the place, little ones, big ones, medium-sized ones. And according to all the worshippers, it was where their God would dwell. And so God instructed his people to build a tent. But this is amazing, right? I'm going to go a little off my notes here, but I'm going to just share this with you. When God told Exodus 25, when God told his people to build a tent, he did not tell them to build a temple. He said, put up a tent. Look at this. Jump forward all the way to the Acts. And we could even go to, even before we get to New Testament, we go to King David. David wanted to build God a temple. Remember that? David wanted to build God a temple. God, let me build a temple. And God said, no, you're not going to build me a temple. I want your son to build me a temple. But you're not going to build me a temple. Even then, God's response was, why do I need a temple? Why do I need a building? I don't need a building. And I'll allow you to build a building. Well, here's what happened. They built a building for God. And God did dwell in that temple. His presence was near to them for a while. Right? And they began to worship the building. They thought they had fit God into a box. And so when their enemies came, particularly the Babylonians, when they came and destroyed their temple, they thought, oh no, God has abandoned us. God is gone. He's gone back into their homes or wherever they are. We don't have a temple. We don't have a place to keep them. They won't have a box. So then we go to Stephen the martyr. He's being stoned. He's about to be stoned to death for following Christ and preaching Christ. And he talks about God. And he talks about in his final sermon to his persecutors. He says, your God is not a God that dwells in temple. He doesn't need a temple. Which is why he told his people back in Exodus 25 to be a tent. Because a tent, you can sit it down as long as God is there. And then when God says, move, you take it up, put it on your belt, and you carry it, and you go wherever God goes. And when God stops, you can take your tent out, and you can put your things in, you can stay there until as long as God is there. Right? And then God decides, you know what, I'm going to move you on over here. I'm going to move you to this part of the wilderness. I'm going to move you into this country. I'm going to move you near this city. And so God, here's the thing. God can never be put in a box. God can never be contained in a building. And the reason that we ask for a tent is because that kept the people from turning God into basically the kind of idol that they could pack up and reconstruct and worship as they did the golden calf. They were subject to God's direction. Not their own. Right? And then Ezekiel comes along, and he's astounded. Ezekiel is distraught. The temple, he's been training to be a priest his whole life. Ezekiel's been training to be a priest his entire life. And now he has been taken into exile to Babylon. And he is lamenting because he's been training to be a priest, but now the Babylonians have destroyed the temple. And all the people are crying out, oh, God has left us, he's forsaken us, he's forgotten about us. And Ezekiel's joining with them, oh, God, you've forgotten about us. And then God meets and gives a vision to Ezekiel, meets with Ezekiel down by the river. And God says to Ezekiel, do you really think that I'm limited to building? And Ezekiel has a little bit of a tough time saying, no, I don't. It takes a little bit of a conversation between Ezekiel and God until Ezekiel arrives and says, wait a second, the building's not there yet, you're speaking to me. So, you must not be limited to the building. And God tells Ezekiel, I want you to go tell your people, even if you're far away in the city of Babylon, I want you to tell my people who've been taken captive. I don't need that physical building. Jesus is coming to Jerusalem. Next week we're going to celebrate this. Palm Sunday. He comes in person running on a donkey, and there are different kinds of symbols there. We'll talk a little bit about that next week. And he rides in, and people are ready to cross the king. They're ready to give him a palace. They're ready to lead him to the temple. They're ready to do all sorts of things. And he comes, and he approaches the temple. Mary approaches the temple. And he's not being arrogant. He's not being cocky. He's not like, yeah, I'm in this place. No, he's not like that at all. He's like, this is what he says. He says, this building, this temple is going to be destroyed. Well, right away, all of a sudden, those people were ready to crowd and people were like, whoa, wait a second. Whoa, wait, no. Our Messiah is going to reign from here. Like, you need this building. Jesus says, this building's going to be destroyed. And then they remind him how many decades it took to build that building. Jesus, don't you realize it took this long to build this magnificent building? Jesus says, I will rebuild it in 3 days. Whoa! That's kind of mind-blowing. Later, I believe it's Peter. Maybe in John's Gospel, who recounts this. He's looking back, and the disciples are reflecting after the resurrection. Jesus said he would destroy, not that he would, but the temple would be destroyed. He would rebuild it in 3 days. By the way, they called it blasphemy. They called it a blasphemer for that. And upon reflection, they say, he was talking about his body. 3 days would be raised. What is the new temple? As Christians, we're not looking for a new temple to be built on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. We're not. Not that there's some Christians who want. They're being misguided, right? We're not looking for a new temple to build. There may be a temple that's built somewhere, there may not be. It's to us that doesn't make any difference because Jesus has already rebuilt the temple. And he has said to us, you are the living stones in this temple. You are the living temple. He rebuilt it in 3 days, the cornerstone was set. All of the living stones of the temple now, where spiritual sacrifices are made, a holy priesthood abides. It's us. We are the temple. And in the end, Revelation 19, God tells us that in the end, his design is the dwelling of God will be with men. God will come and dwell with us. Now, the Holy Spirit, yes, he dwells with us. Fullness of the presence of God will dwell in this holy temple. That's you, and that's me. Now let me close. Sometimes you may feel like you're a rejected stone. Forgotten, left out, excluded, rejected. Perhaps you've been told, or maybe you have told yourself, that you just don't fit. You don't have a place. Who am I? What do I have to give? I just don't belong. But here's the truth. God is building a temple for his own dwelling. And he's building it out of stones that the world might reject. He might will. This is what Peter says. Don't be surprised if your identity is in Christ that you should be rejected by believers or by the world as well, because that's exactly what they did with the cornerstone. Right? But Jesus chooses people, living stones, out of the rubble. He picks us up out of the rubble, and he builds a temple that God himself, the High Holy One, will dwell in. Not those big, beautiful boulders that just look perfect for a temple, but the rubble, the little, tossed out, just to be taped over, walked over, driven over, unseen, forgotten, no good, rubble. It's you, that's me. God builds a temple out of us, living stones, living stones. Jesus, as it were, sort of the dark horse, the champion that no one saw coming, the unexpected one, the one who rose from the rubble to become the cornerstone. The champion, the one there, when everyone was looking for someone who was packing a sword and was skilled in fighting and battle and those sorts of things, was ready to be crowned king and ushered into the physical temple, Jesus rose up. Jesus rose up, not just from the rubble. Jesus rose up from the grave, where Isaiah says that grave was even made with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Christ rose up. Didn't see that coming. He rose up to be our champion, to be our cornerstone. And when we are in Christ, you too rise. You are built up as a living stone. Would you stand with me this morning? Our Father, we pause here before we go on through our day, this day you've given to us. Say thank you. Say thank you because we all know, some extent or another, we know what it's like to be rejected, to be forgotten, to be forsaken, to be left alone, to be excluded, to be tossed out as rubble. Lord, we all have some experience of that. Lord, I pray that you would be with the humility, with the great humility, kind of humility that would characterize rubble, that we would look to you and recognize that you, the cornerstone, that you reach for us and you place us into your temple. May our identity be in you. May our lives be aligned to you. May our actions and our behaviors and our words and our thoughts, our attitudes, our desires, our purpose, our everything be aligned to you, O God, our Lord and our Savior. Lord, as dead stones, we cry out to you, O God, have mercy on us. Lord, lift us up out of the rubble and include us so we too might be a part of that dwelling place, that temple from the north. Now, Lord, as you look upon this congregation, I pray you instill within every heart that same kind of humility, recognizing we are nothing but rubble. But we are made into something precious, chosen and precious in you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Go with us now from this place, and may go in the peace and the joy that Christ gives.